Hello and welcome to Insight. I'm Natasha. Bhaskar, India's gross domestic product increased by 7.2% in the October-December 2017 quarter, showing a sustained pickup in growth recovery in an economy that was hit hard by issues related to the rollout of the goods and services tax and lingering impact of demonetization. For the entire financial year due to end on 31st March, estimates suggest a possible growth of around 6.6%. This is lower than the 7.5% growth registered in 2016-17. But given that in previous quarters of the current financial year, growth was 5.7% and then 6.5%, it's safe to conclude that the growth slowdown plaguing India has bottomed out. So is it really big leap in numbers? What it means for overall economic activity? To tell us more on this, joining us, a very esteemed panel, Professor Aman Agarwal, a Director, Indian Institute of Finance. So thanks very much, Professor, for joining us on the program. Also, Maithili Bhusnurmath, Senior Journalist. Thanks very much, Maithili, for joining us on the program. And Ashok, Dasgupta, Senior Journalist. Thanks very much, Mr. Dasgupta, for joining us on the program. So, Professor, is this really a big leap in GDP numbers?
No, I think it's a very encouraging number which has come forth, given the fact that we have had two previous quarters which are fairly low, and then that was dampening the impact. Mm-hmm. Not only that, these numbers have come quite robust, we have also seen the fact that there has been a lot of impetus given by the government in terms of large number of projects initiated both by the public and the private sector, mm-hmm. both by development authorities and the private builders in construction and other fields, to be put forward and been delivered. And that's what has actually given this kind of impetus. Mm-hmm. The other component we saw was that the Moody's have still stuck on to 7.6% for the next year, given the fact that they see the fiscal spending going up, which is going up from almost about 3.2% projected to almost 4% right. as of today, which has been mm-hmm. projected yesterday by almost 113% year to year for the last three quarters. Mm-hmm. Despite that fact, the Moody's have, which are very particular about fiscal spending and fiscal deficits, mm-hmm. have kept it stable. Clearly shows that there is an international interest in terms of doing things. Mm-hmm. And also a very good step which took place this year was that the budget was presented almost a month in advance, okay. which gives the government almost 2 months mm-hmm. to make necessary allocations and structures, and even private companies, organizations, and large institutions, large public sector and private sector institutions, mm-hmm. to make projections for their next year's growth and try and induce that to be coming forth in their own financial year ending. Okay. So in my opinion, this is quite encouraging, and mm-hmm. the fact that we are going much stronger than China, mm-hmm. Keeping the impetus and focusing on the revamping of Make in India, mm-hmm. which has been targeted from November onwards, according to the Prime Minister Modi, mm-hmm. on jobs and growth. And we could see different states now coming out okay. in terms of trying and inviting a large number of enterprises from within the country and overseas mm-hmm. to come and invest. And I think this will give a good impetus to
both. In a way, we are saying that numbers has actually exceeded expectations. But Maithili, what's your take? There are many experts who also say that what's surprising in this was a self-inflicted wound, and we are just recovering because we asked for this wound, demonetization and GST. And there's no big story if the numbers are doing fine. We were doing much, much better in year 2016. And if one looks at the consumption, even if one looks at the manufacturing sector, this is what the GDP says, the manufacturing, the agriculture, construction, certain services show overall recovery. But if I draw a comparison, the growth in the manufacturing sector is around 5.1% compared to 7.9% in 2016-17. So what really is the good news here?
Well, I think in macroeconomics, it all depends on how you want to look at the glass. You want to look at it as half empty or half full. Mm-hmm. So the question is that demonetization was or is a done deal. It has happened. Mm-hmm. And the economy did take a hit. GST is a slightly different kettle of fish because it was a necessary reform. And though, even though it did have disruptive effects, you could say that perhaps it is worth the price that we have paid for it. Mm-hmm. Demonetization, I think the jury is still out. And most people feel that, yes, it was in some ways a self-inflicted wound. Mm-hmm. So having said that, has the economy recovered? It's not a big leap in growth as you described it, but mm-hmm. definitely it is a positive mm-hmm. because many of the sectors which were doing badly in the past have recovered some of the momentum. Mm-hmm. The bigger question really is, will this recovery be sustained? Because if you look at the fourth quarter numbers that we'll expect later in the year, right. they will also definitely look better, but that's mainly because of the base effect. Mm-hmm. The comparable quarter of the previous year, the last quarter or the last year, was very, very bad. Mm-hmm. So in relative comparison to that, because numbers are always in comparison relative to the year on year for the comparable mm-hmm. period last year. Mm-hmm. So there is that statistical illusion. So we might end up looking much better. Mm-hmm. The question is, are we much better? Right. And there the thing, well, I think my judgment would be that we mm-hmm. are definitely better, not as good as we need to be or we ought to be, mm-hmm. but certainly better. And to that extent, I think it is certainly good news.
So in a way, we can say that the economy is recovering from the slowdown it witnessed earlier?
Yes, definitely. I would say it is recovering, but I think it needs to recover much faster given our dire need to remove, you know, so many people who are living under the poverty line. And given our potential also, we're still growing below potential.
Right.
So that is what we need to get. I think we need to compete with ourselves rather than against China.
Okay. Now, what these figures really tell us about the overall economic activity, because, you know, there are several reports and, you know, in many of these reports, it says that if it is really a true picture of the real economic activity, if one looks at the e-payments actually play a very, very strong role in taking the GDP growth to a higher level. In fact, it has an impact of 2 to 3% on the overall growth. So, you know, if one has to look at different sectors and the role it plays in contributing to the overall figures, is this really a true picture of the economic activity?
Well, to the extent the GDP numbers, you know, you have to take them with a pinch of salt. They do get revised, and that's true not only of India. It's true all over the world.
Okay.
But by and large, I think our statistics are fairly robust. So certainly to the extent that this is suggesting a trend as in recovery, I would think it is good news. And if you look at the sectoral breakup also, almost across the board, there's been it's a broad-based recovery. And three particular sectors where there's growth performance is good are, you know, agriculture, manufacturing, and construction, as you mentioned. These are particularly good because given the percentage of the population still dependent on agriculture. The fact that agriculture has done quite well, despite the high base, agriculture has grown at about 4.1% in the third quarter, as against 7.5 in the comparable period of last year. So despite the high base of the previous year, which would normally depress the figures, we've grown at 4.1. Also despite the fact that the kharif harvest has not been too good. So what this would suggest is that in the farm sector, people are diversifying away from crops to horticulture, floriculture, you know, animal husbandry, dairy. And to that extent, we're insulating ourselves to some extent from the impact of the monsoon. And that is very good because we need to insulate the farmer from complete dependence only on crop income.
Also a clear reflection of major of the economic decisions taken in other sectors like the food processing industry. And, you know, many such measures also in the agriculture sector, what this budget talks about. And also what the economic survey has talked about that, you know, agriculture remains an area of concern. What, in your opinion, you know, is really the major takeaway from this particular GDP data? Is, you know, India's growth story on track?
I think the growth story is on track. We are recovering, as you said, from partly a self-inflicted wound. But then, if you say you are the fastest growing economy, you are going to beat China, etc., I think it only adds to the feel-good factor. The point is, green shoots are there, but are they sustainable? Second thing is, you have to look at the fiscal deficit target. As of now, it has already exceeded the target, the revised estimates. Third, what I mean to say is that, yes, we are on the right flight path, but headwinds are there. And added to that, I would say, which has not been discussed till now, are the bird hits. The bird hits are these frauds that are now certainly surfacing. Now, that per se, if you look at, let's say, PNB, it doesn't make much of a difference. But what it has affected is the confidence of people in public sector banks. As it is, because equity markets were going up, people were investing in mutual funds. So there was a shift away from fixed deposits to mutual funds. Now you have the specter of inflation coming up, which is why SBI has already, you know, raised its deposit rates. So with inflation likely to be there, oil prices, you are uncertain where it will go, and the lack of confidence in public sector banks per se. Now, just a hike in fixed deposits, whether people will move to public sector banks or not, is still certain. Till now, 70% used to be, you know, banking system, almost 65 to 70% was public sector banks.
So but correct me if I'm wrong.
These over there.
Correct me if I'm wrong, because these challenges existed last year as well, and still we registered, you know, decent growth numbers. So what does this really say? Are we actually, you know, be it the challenge of the NPA or the inflation or the gap between the fiscal and the monetary
NPA
policy?
NPA was something that we have been dealing with for the past, I think, 2 or 3 years, right? And every quarter or half yearly, the norms used to get more stringent. The RBI, as the regulator, used to Now what it has done, it is still more stringent, mm-hmm. and rightly so. What has affected the banking system right now are the frauds that are surfacing. Mm-hmm. Earlier we used to think that Vijay Mallya, mm-hmm. that 9,000 odd crore,
okay.
is a showcase, the biggest fraud. Mm-hmm. Now people are beating that. Mm-hmm. You have the PNB fraud coming up.
Okay.
And now since the other banks, mm-hmm. they are also very wary of where their
okay.
funds are going.
Okay.
They are reporting to CBI. Mm-hmm. And one doesn't see where it is likely to end. This
okay.
will go on for certain months.
Maithili, you'd like
but
to
definitely,
respond.
Mm-hmm. Definitely, mm-hmm. the fact that GDP growth is there is very good news. Mm-hmm. What I mean to say is that we are on the right track. We are in the right direction. Mm-hmm. We are on the right flight path. But then there are obstacles
true.
That are coming.
True, in. True. And let's not lose sight of the major challenges and concerns also. And of course, one is that, do you think that the whole discourse on banking sector has now changed? Earlier, we were only talking about the NPAs. Now, we're also talking about the banking scams, you know, in terms of LOUs, frauds that are happening. Earlier it was just about the business investors' confidence. Now, it's also about the citizen of this country, whether they really want to, you know, keep their money in banks. So the whole fear factor that which has now suddenly emerged, the sort of credibility which is at stake, is largely, you know, a major reason which can hamper the growth?
No, this is where I'd like to disagree with Ashok, because mm-hmm. the fact is that these are predominantly, or the entire public sector banks are predominantly owned by government. This
right.
is a majority government mm-hmm. stake. So you have as much faith in PNB as you have in Government of India.
True.
And I don't think there's any citizen in the country who doesn't have faith in Government of India mm-hmm. in the abstract, as in terms of the government, because mm-hmm. if it is your government and you didn't have faith in it, what are you doing in this country, I would ask.
Right.
So to that extent, and which is why you see there's been absolutely no run on any branch of PNB. Mm-hmm. The average citizen still has faith in Punjab National Bank, mm-hmm. has not withdrawn his deposits, mm-hmm. and had this happened in any private sector bank, I assure you it would have been very different.
Okay.
If you remember about 10 years ago, there was a run on a large private sector bank, mm-hmm. and the Reserve Bank of India had to intervene. So this is where public ownership, government ownership, makes a huge difference as far as people's confidence is concerned. Mm-hmm. Of course, fraud is never very good news,
sure.
but fraud is as mm-hmm. much a part of modern day banking mm-hmm. as, say, crime in society. Mm-hmm. Can we have any society without crime? Absolutely
okay.
not. Mm-hmm. Likewise, you can never have banking without fraud or without NPA.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, what can we do to reduce the incidence of fraud?
Mm-hmm.
What can we do to minimize the recurrence? I say minimize, I don't say eliminate.
But is this
never
typical of public sector banks?
Not at all.
Mm-hmm.
If you look, there's a very large private sector bank mm-hmm. which also has a huge exposure to Gitanjali Gems.
Right.
But such is the PR of the private sector banks that name of the bank seldom comes up in media.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact is that public sector banks, it's easier to slam a public sector bank than to slam a private sector bank.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, public sector banks, not in the case of fraud, but at least in the case of NPAs,
right.
you have high NPAs precisely because they extended loans to infrastructure
mm-hmm.
at the time when the private sector bank was not willing. Look
right.
at what happened to demonetization.
Mm-hmm.
I myself have an account with the private sector bank.
Mm-hmm.
I went 3 times to that bank to get my money changed.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I was told, sorry, nothing available.
Right.
It was the public sector banks.
Mm-hmm.
So when you expect the public sector banks to deliver more than just commerce
mm-hmm.
and also attend to social, political, economic objectives of the government,
right.
you cannot judge them by the same yardstick. This
right.
is not an apology
mm-hmm.
for the wrongs that happen in public sector banks,
mm-hmm.
but it's not because of their public sector
mm-hmm.
status alone
mm-hmm.
that frauds happen.
Okay, so let's not paint everyone
yeah.
with the same brush.
Absolutely.
Okay, Professor Agarwal, your take on this, you know, because this is something which again remains a major, major challenge. What happens to the, you know, investors' confidence and also the public sector banks? How far will they go ahead in lending for these infrastructure and big projects? These are certain concerns which actually has an immediate impact on the overall growth story of the country.
I think, you see, the government is taking due action. I've been voicing even at Lok Sabha and other places, accountability
mm-hmm.
when NPAs comes into position is very important. The top officials have to be questioned, they have to be brought into the structure so that we can actually nab these NPAs. If you really look at NPAs, the kind of waivers which have been granted in the last 15, 20 years, almost about 15 to 16 lakh crores of waivers have been granted by different governments in the last 17 years.
Mm-hmm.
That means almost on an average about 1 lakh crore rupees waivers have been granted so far.
Mm-hmm.
That means the economy with the current GDP, which has been projected in the last so many years, has the capacity to absorb that 1 lakh crore. So
okay.
we are still within that fit of
mm-hmm.
1 lakh crore, so
mm-hmm.
that will not majorly impact
mm-hmm.
the GDP growth rate. Secondly, when we look at the foreign exchange reserves, how strong are we? You know, our macroeconomic indicators, as I said clearly, do give a perspective. Now, when we look at our, the foreign exchange reserves, they've gone up to $4.17 billion as of today, in February itself, mid-reporting February. And they're expected to close, if I opinion, about $4.20 billion by end March. So we are actually going up. That clearly is a reflection of the fact that there is an international confidence which is going up.
Okay.
Please understand, whether it is people within the country or overseas, they are afraid of some of these news. But the more thing which they're afraid of is if there is no action taken on them. And fortunately, we see a strict action being taken. The fact that the government has come out and said that anything which is above 50 crores, which is given out as a loan and has termed to something like an NPA, should be reported to the government immediately, clearly shows the concern which is there.
Okay.
In my opinion, the more important concern which now the government needs to come out with is the fact that they need to look at how do we get this money back into the system. Just taking over assets or putting people behind bars is not going to solve the problem. It is actually talking to these people, whether it is government officials, bankers, or it is a question of those people who are concerned, the directors of those companies. I think we need to bring them in the discussion panel with the CBI, with the Enforcement Directorate, other economic offence officers, and get the money back into the system. I remember vividly that Harshad Mehta, when he was caught way back in 99, when about 4,500 crores worth of scam was done, he said that, please give me 2 days' time, give me my diary, and I will bring this money back on the table in the market within 2 days. Now, he was not granted that because CBI has always had this police structure where it is criminalizing. You are being criminalized. Put behind bars is important. And instead of getting the thing up and trying to find out who else is involved. What is important is first get the money. You already know who are they. You already know who are these people. You already have their tabs. Once you get the money into the system, you automatically actually secure the taxpayer, the common man's money. And after that, you can deal with whoever you want to deal with in whatever sense you want to deal with them. And I think that is what is, where, in my opinion, important step for the government to now take so that the confidence is restored. The fact that Moody's has rated us fairly well, the fact that FDIs are growing up, and it is growing up fairly well. The industry is responding positively. The GST numbers are going up. Clearly shows that there is confidence. There may be a little shift in this particular quarter, but I don't see as a major hit to the economy.
But overall, you're saying that accountability in the system is returning in a way that the government is making the fraudsters accountable for all that they have done. And there is greater, you know, in terms of, are we seeing, liquidity really returning, in the banks. But overall, you know, challenges also in terms of the monetary policy, because though, the big challenges for the RBI, will it really relax interest rates or not? On the other side, when we come back, let's also talk about the gap that exists between the fiscal and the monetary policy, and also the overall macroeconomic stability and challenges for the Indian economy. On the other side, stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching Insight. As the economic survey this year suggests, the return to growth is followed by concerns about macroeconomic variables, not just the fiscal deficit, but also inflation. The gap in the fiscal and the monetary policy, what about revival in private investment? Now, these are the challenges which the economy continues to face, and how far the days ahead in the economy will address this. Coming back to you, Maithili. Consumption is one issue, you know, which we've really been worried about. Do you think that these GDP growth figures also talk about the private consumption really picking up over time?
See, private consumption should, for the simple reason that the government has followed a fairly expansionary policy. And if you look at even the 7th Pay Commission recommendations the government implemented quite wholeheartedly, we should see consumption pick up. And we, if you look at data on utilization of capacity, there is some evidence, not very strong of course, that capacity utilization is increasing and pricing power is to some extent returning to manufacturers. If that happens and capacity gets more fully utilized, then you will see investment picking up. And the flip side really of consumption is investment. And there the third quarter numbers for GDP show a fairly strong growth in fixed capital formation, which is basically an alternative way of describing investment. And that seems to have grown in the third quarter by 12% as against 6.9% in the previous quarter. Of course, if we look at the share of gross capital formation as a percentage of GDP, it's more or less the same. Mm-hmm. So it's a little early for us to say, should we look at that higher rate of growth, mm-hmm. or should we look at the fact that as a percentage of GDP, it's not changed. Mm-hmm. But overall, I would think, particularly because the government has been following a fairly expansionary fiscal policy, mm-hmm. even if you look at the higher fiscal deficit for this year as mm-hmm. well as for the next year, I think it's only a matter of time because before demand picks up and then automatically investment will follow. Okay. But for right now, it's a little early for us to say, yes, that battle has been won. Mm-hmm. But I do expect that, particularly because global recovery is also happening. So mm-hmm. export demand should also pick up. Okay. So higher domestic demand, higher export demand together, they should see higher capacity utilization. Mm-hmm. And then investment should normally follow.
Okay. Mr. Dasgupta, is the disruptive phase of GST and demonetization finally over? And the manufacturing sector, you know, if one looks at the data available, you know, it talks about agriculture, fisheries, forestry, and, you know, also the auto sector, manufacturing, everything picking up. So can we really say that, you know, the bad time of the GST implementation is finally over?
I think more or less, yeah, it's over. Mm-hmm. You see, if you look at the demonetization effect, that was a sort of a bolt. And obviously, it was intended to rake in, you know, black money, etc., stop the proliferation of black money in the system. Mm-hmm. And which are the sectors it affected most? Obviously, the real estate sector. Now, do we see the real estate sector doing well now? Mm-hmm. No. For the simple reason that the whole system mm-hmm. of transactions mm-hmm. in real estate sector has changed. Mm-hmm. Earlier, there was a fixed component of 60-40, mm-hmm. you know, black and white.
Right.
Now, the developers, builders, mm-hmm. and the secondary market, they mm-hmm. themselves are very wary of handling black money. Mm-hmm. First of all, maybe it has really reduced. And second, most of the transactions are in white. Mm-hmm. Now, it is yet to pick up. Developers themselves are saying mm-hmm. maybe it will take 2 or 3 quarters more.
Okay.
The other thing, mm-hmm. which was a basic change, mm-hmm. is that earlier developers in the real estate sector mm-hmm. were concentrating more on luxurious apartments mm-hmm. and not affordable homes. Mm-hmm. Now, over time, this trend is changing. Developers have realized that the shortage mm-hmm. actually is in affordable homes, and they're now trying to concentrate on that. And that luxurious apartments were for investments. And that is not picking up for the same reason. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the construction sector as a whole, then you will find mm-hmm. that it has done well mm-hmm. as far as the GDP figures are concerned. Mm-hmm. Now, that probably is because the government expenditure mm-hmm. in construction, let's say roads, etc., mm-hmm. was pretty much high, and that kept the sector going.
Okay.
So you have growth in that. Mm-hmm. Now, again, I would say I'm not being cynical or pessimistic. Mm-hmm. The thing is, when fiscal deficit is already 113% of the revised target mm-hmm. of 3.5, the government does not have the same, should not have the same cash flow to go in for the similar pace of construction, mm-hmm. roads, etc. Mm-hmm. Now, if that is cut down, obviously, it will affect the overall sector and growth, etc. Mm-hmm. Now, the point is this. Will the government keep on spending or it will stick to the revised target? Mm-hmm. That is a decision the government will have to take.
Okay. And how much fiscal space or fiscal room does the government really enjoy at this moment? You know, let's not forget, global commodity prices is a major challenge. And this is something which even in the budget, the finance minister clearly acknowledged. The economic survey talks about almost like $4 trillion of investment in the infrastructure sector. Now, these are huge figures. And, you know, it also talks about major investment. We're also looking at investors' confidence. Look at the key sectors like services, manufacturing, industry. How do you really see all these sectors, the way they have performed in this particular quarter?
No, I think when we talk of fiscal space, I also spoke about it 3 months back, mm-hmm. when we had projected around 3.2%, that we have fiscal space going to almost 4.5%. Mm-hmm. The important component is, what are we using this 100 basis points for in terms of the fiscal space? Are we using it for growth-oriented projects which are going to reap revenue for you tomorrow? Mm-hmm. Or are we using them to be spent on waivers, subsidies, bank loan waivers, and things like that?
Right.
If you're going to be using it for waivers and dead investments, as we call them, then certainly this is a big cost to the nation and this will not result in growth tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But if you're looking at projects, like the bullet train just come in, the highways, which is going to bring connectivity, the rural roadways which you're trying to connect, the mandis being connected, the large with the small, and so on and so forth, trying to boost up growth and development in terms of agriculture, manufacturing, mm-hmm. creating that space, digital framework, mm-hmm. you know, cyber security. If you're looking at these kind of things, which are actually going to be bringing in reap fruits, I think India does not need to be bogged down by this the developed world fiscal deficit figure per se. We have that fiscal space, we can go ahead. And the fact, as I said, mm-hmm. we have fairly strong fiscal foreign exchange reserves. Mm-hmm. We have other things which are fairly strong with this country going forward. Mm-hmm. The confidence in the masses and the people of this country towards this government mm-hmm. is fairly strong. Like Maithili said, there is no bank run which has taken place despite these frauds, which is not the case. Now, this clearly shows that there is a confidence in the mm-hmm. the system, in the mm-hmm. people, in the government. Mm-hmm. And that confidence is very critical. The FDI flows which are coming in, mm-hmm. the kind of UP Investment Summit took place, the Maharashtra Investment Summit took place, the Uttarakhand Investment, mm-hmm. the kind of people, not only from within the country, but industries from about 8, 10, 20 different countries which came in wanting to invest, mm-hmm. clearly shows mm-hmm. that despite some of these errors which are being identified and being attended to by the government, mm-hmm. they is a strong will to go forward and bring growth for themselves with the growth of India.
Okay.
So from that perspective, I see mm-hmm. this fiscal spending space. And we're still, as I said, we're mm-hmm. only at 4%. This 113% makes it a little scary. We're actually around 4% of the GDP, mm-hmm. which we're projecting of about $2.6 trillion of GDP, which is projected. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, we are still looking at what will be the next quarter growth. They may be a subdued because one of the largest markets in India, which is one of the critical markets, does not contribute so much to the taxes.
Okay, so in a way, you're saying that the phase of paranoia is more or less over, and we should actually look at the larger picture. Let's look at the international rating agencies. Let's also look at the ease of doing business, what the IMF says, what the World Bank says, and most importantly, the upgrading, you know, in terms of also by Moody coming after a decade. So largely, one has to assess the economy. We talk about manufacturing, private consumption, and revenue. From these three perspectives, are we actually going fine?
Well, I would say certainly in manufacturing, the news seems really good so far. And mm-hmm. manufacturing is important because that's where the jobs are going to come from. Mm-hmm. But precisely because manufacturing offers promise of jobs, that is where any lack of reluctance of banks to lend is mm-hmm. going to hurt us most.
True.
So I think it's important that even as we try and get, you know, the culprits who have committed fraud or the NPAs, willful defaulters, mm-hmm. even as we try to bring them to book, and here I disagree slightly with Aman, in the sense that there's no contradiction between bringing them to book and recovering of assets. Mm-hmm. You know, the two can continue simultaneously. You can still get a Nirav Modi back to India and make him face the music, and mm-hmm. you can go after recovering of his assets. There's no, you know, they're not mutually exclusive.
Okay.
But I think it's important not to have the fear factor in public sector bank officials. Well, ultimately, at the end of the day, mm-hmm. the private sector banks are doing essentially retail lending. Lending for houses, lending for cars, lending for automobiles, where there's not much risk.
Right.
Okay, and that's why you don't have high NPAs. Mm-hmm. But somebody has to lend for infrastructure, for power, for roads, for bridges, mm-hmm. for cement, for steel. Mm-hmm. So if nobody's there going to be there to lend for these sectors, then we're going to really suffer.
Right.
And it is the public sector banks essentially who lend to these sectors.
Mm-hmm.
Now, today, if every public sector bank official is going to be busy looking at all the loans of over 50 crores, you know, spending all his time on compliance and mm-hmm. always looking over his shoulder whether the CVC, the CBI, mm-hmm. the ED mm-hmm. is going to come breathing down, come breathing down his neck. And this is true not only for serving officials, even retired officials are constantly worried.
Mm-hmm.
So they just will not lend.
Right.
So you cannot have that freezing of credit.
Mm-hmm.
That is very harmful. So mm-hmm. I think I'm very scared. In fact, I worry that we are going to shoot ourselves in the foot by going overboard on this. It's necessary to accept that in banking is a business of taking risks.
Mm-hmm.
Some of your risks work out, some decisions will be good,
mm-hmm.
some will not be good. As long as there is no malafide,
mm-hmm.
you should accept that NPAs are part of banking.
Mm-hmm.
So in the process
and even the very definition of willful default.
Yes, it's very difficult because mm-hmm. that means you're saying that the person has the ability to repay.
Right.
Now, who's to judge whether he has the ability to repay?
Mm-hmm.
So leave it to the banks, and this is where I think it's important
mm-hmm.
that even within the public sector framework, you can have banks mm-hmm. perform efficiently by separating ownership and control.
Right.
If the government and the RBI do not interfere in the operational mm-hmm. autonomy of banks,
mm-hmm.
they will be willing to function as commercial entities.
Mm-hmm.
Today, that is not happening.
Okay.
You're tying them up in knots,
mm-hmm.
and that is very bad for the economy.
And what implications does this really have for the monetary policy, these GDP numbers?
See, as far as the monetary policy is concerned, I think essentially, I think the die is cast. Because ultimately, the U.S. Federal Reserve has become the de facto central bank for the entire world. Mm-hmm. And with the U.S. Federal Reserve set to raise interest rates, not just thrice, maybe even four times, possibly, because the U.S. recovery is going well on track. Right. And there is a strong possibility of the U.S. economy overheating. Mm-hmm. Inflation has already crossed 2%, mm-hmm. and it might continue to be over 2%, in which case you will find, and the U.S. Trump is giving a fiscal stimulus, perhaps a needless fiscal stimulus. Mm-hmm. So the U.S. economy is going to recover very smartly, in which case the Fed will raise interest rates sharper and more quickly than before. Mm-hmm. In which case, I think the our own central bank will have no alternative, and we've already seen inflation also edge up. Right. So unfortunately, we will not get any support from the monetary policy, and mm-hmm. rightly so, because I think at the monetary policy now mm-hmm. is perhaps faced with no options but to tighten. Mm-hmm. So I'm afraid we will not get any support from
not
monetary policy.
Any support from the RBI. What's your take on this, the implications this can have for the monetary policy, the GDP numbers?
Well, this is exactly the fear mm-hmm. that I was trying to point out in the first session. Mm-hmm. You know, what Maithili just now, you know, very aptly described. Mm-hmm. First, the inflation factor. Now, because of inflation, as I said earlier, SBI has already hiked the deposit rate by about 10 to 75 basis points. Mm-hmm. Other banks will follow suit. Apart from the fact that money is not getting deposited in banks because of higher returns they were going to mutual funds.
Right.
Now they want a reverse flow mm-hmm. into fixed deposits, mm-hmm. etc. Mm-hmm. Second, like it or not, mm-hmm. the fact that banks will now be very wary of lending mm-hmm. is a reality. That 50 crore, etc., all banks are now looking back into their books.
Right.
Now, like was pointed out earlier, mm-hmm. banking is risk. It is a risky business, mm-hmm. and NPAs are there. Absolutely. Which is why for the past almost 2 years, we have been dealing with NPAs. We had a certain figure that this is the NPA. But now we find mm-hmm. that apart from the NPA, there's a big chunk which right. is very different. Mm-hmm. Now, we have the best of systems. Mm-hmm. We take pride in our regulator, the RBI. Mm-hmm. There are umpteen number levels of audit. Despite that, the fact for 7 years, this sort of a transaction or transactions could take place, no amount of mm-hmm. policing will help. Because once the official mm-hmm. gets into a collusion, and not at one level, at various levels, just in one branch, obviously public sector banks, all banks right. are now looking into their books of account. Mm-hmm. Now that per se 11,000 or 12,000 crore is not a very big amount. Mm-hmm. There is sovereign guarantee, no doubt. There will be no run on these banks. Mm-hmm. But the fact that this sort of a thing with connivance can take place is a very negative factor.
Okay. Professor Agarwal, you'd like to respond to this particular issue
of
collusion.
First of all, I do not see any change happening in the monetary policy. He'll mm-hmm. stay put. My opinion on Fed is quite different. Fed, they are going to be very US focused now. Powell, who has taken over, is going to be extensively looking at fiscal spending. Already the market has responded there. Over $1.5 trillion mm-hmm. went out of the market within a span of 5 to 6 days,
right.
which is a big step. Mm-hmm. And there are a large number of other things. I think India and US is quite isolated from that perspective. Yes, mm-hmm. we have trade links and so on and so forth. That's a separate issue altogether. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, Trump may not be good for a large part of the world, but mm-hmm. fortunately, all policies, whether it is visa and others, which are coming out, are fairly favorable mm-hmm. towards India and mm-hmm. Indian structures. That is one side. Secondly, when we talk of NPAs, as I said, 1 lakh crore NPAs being absorbed by the economy every year in terms of waivers given by the government to mm-hmm. banks has already been there. It's a cost to the taxpayer. What are these NPAs? We thought they were NPAs just because of economic structures taking place or recession or something happening or the company not being paying out. Now the NPA which has been coming forth is not because of that. It is the callousness, it is the ignorance or a connivance of bank officials. And I think there needs to be an appropriate fear in them that they can be booked to task. And I think RBI must come out in this month with strictures that if a bank official is found involved in these kind of activities, he will not only lose jobs, but there will be serious steps taken, like in the markets. If someone does a fraud in capital market, he's thrown out of the market for good, for at least 5 years, 10 years in certain places. SEC in the US does it, in India also SEBI does it.
Okay.
Why can't we have similar steps where a bank official is as accountable as a normal officer? Why should the rule of the land be different for a private individual and should be different for a government
officer? Will you also agree with Maithili's point? Oversight is a good thing, and having a necessary a regulatory and transparency mechanism.
We have
also,
more people
will
for
this
it.
Will this have an impact on the future on future lending also?
No,
because we're looking at public sector for larger investments.
3 years, how little spending is done? I have been speaking. The banks are not giving money to the MSME segment. They only giving to large projects, but they're not giving to MSME segment. Manufacturing segment have been suffering. They've been crying out for it. If you took agriculture, NABARD, large amount of funds which come to NABARD never get to the people in the land. They actually go back to the government year on year. When these are taking place, where is the lending taking place, my dear?
Okay.
If it is not taking place, it is not because of their not being there. It's the question here is that we can hire more people. Compliances does not mean a private company, when it files for SEBI, they have to do compliance. They have to hire people to do compliances. They have to incur a cost. Why can't banks and financial institutions do that? And they already have the framework. They have people in their houses to do that
I'll
job.
I'll quickly take a short break, and next when we come back, we'll also talk about what implications does the GDP data have on job growth, and what about job growth, because that remains a major issue in the final segment, major issues and challenges as far as the Indian economy is concerned. In the final segment, stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching Insider. Is 7% growth enough? Remember back when the current Indian government was sworn in, inheriting a recovering economy growing at coincidentally 6.6%. Many officials insisted that double-digit growth was around the corner. India growing at 5%, 6% or even 7% is not an India that is going to face up to the challenge of youth unemployment. This was Finance Minister Arun Jaitley who had warned back then. In India, a country where a million young people join the job market every month, 7% growth simply isn't enough. Finally, what really are the major challenges and concerns for the economy? Coming back to you, Mr. Dasgupta, on this, what really, in your opinion, will be the major challenges from here? And most importantly, we're looking at jobs, job creation. You know, all the good, you know, GDP figures are fine, but is it really translating into the number of jobs which the government promised to create?
Well, I'm afraid no. You see, creating jobs is, I think, the biggest challenge, not only for our government, for any government in the world. First of all, look at what is happening. We have in our GDP pie, services sector is the maximum. Now, obviously, between if you take services and manufacturing, it is the manufacturing sector that creates more jobs. Now, even in that, if you have more automation, you have less jobs.
Right.
You need labor-intensive items. You produce labor-intensive items, you have more jobs. In fact, to give you an example, you know, in China, Michelin has a factory where almost three-fourths of the unit is totally automated tire manufacturing. One section is absolutely manual. And when we asked, why is this? He said, this is to provide jobs to the Chinese. Now, if this is the way you have to create jobs, then we are in that challenge that we are facing is maximum. Because labor intensive, if you look at, you have leather items, you have gems and jewelry, and all these. Now, again, coming back to the frauds that are taking place, gems and jewelry, especially diamond studded jewelry, which is a major component of exports, at least on paper, is now under the lens.
Okay.
So that trade, I think, for temporarily, for some time, is affected because of these. Then you have the agricultural sector. Now there, what you need for creating jobs, as it is in agriculture, you have more manpower than the addition to GDP. So there needs to be a shift from there to manufacturing. But that's a different story altogether. In the agriculture sector, what you need is food processing industries, small food processing industries, so that a lot of the labor can be employed in that, and you can, you know, minimize the wastage that is there in, you know, vegetables, horticulture, whatever.
Okay.
Now, these will create jobs. But then the government's, you know, stress has been, now if you look at that mudra loan sector, that you yourself be an entrepreneur. Now, I would say that the government policies, what they have on paper is absolutely fine. This is to take the country forward. But there is a lot of, I would say, negatives in its implementation. Now, take that small mudra scheme itself. Offhand, it's a brilliant scheme. You know, you have loans of 50,000, 1 lakh, 5 to 10 lakhs, various categories. But I was surprised to see that even in this mudra loan scheme, there is fraud taking place. Something like 6 lakh crores has been wiped out by certain branch or official. Now, if this is the way that the, I would say, the public sector or whoever employee functions, then no matter what you have on paper, you cannot reach your destination in time.
So job creation is a major issue, and we have seen, as Mr. Dasgupta also was pointing out, a shift in terms of creating jobs rather than actually seeking jobs. And that has been the approach of the government. Also, in your opinion, Maithili, what really are the major challenges? We're looking at agriculture, that remains a major issue, the farm sector. And also, the impact of the external sector. Has the external sector, you know, been a drag on growth in terms of trade deficit figures, and also the way the global trade has shown some sort of a rebounding, but we haven't really, the exports haven't picked up in that a big way. So do you see a gap between the two?
Well, yes, certainly exports haven't been of any help at all, and that's mainly because exchange rate has been not in the favor of exporters at all. The rupee has been appreciating against the dollar, and that is never good news for exporters, because even though export demand is driven partly by, you know, overseas demand, the exchange rate also plays a key factor. And even a time when you're seeing rising trade protectionism, the fact is that we need every little support for exports. Right. Along with that, there have been problems with GST and exporters getting refunds. So the export sector has particularly been handicapped. So I think there are some headwinds and tailwinds. The biggest tailwind, I think, for the Indian economy right now is a global recovery, the so-called synchronized global recovery, because the US, EU, Japan, there are signs all over the world that economic recovery is happening. But whenever there is such widespread economic recovery, it's not necessarily good news for us, because along with that comes rise in commodity prices. And rising oil prices in particular are a very bad headwind for us. It has huge implications for inflation, fiscal deficit, as well as the trade balance. So there are some important headwinds also: rising inflation, rising commodity prices, growing protectionism, and of course, as I told you, the possibility that a credit might, supply of credit might squeeze up, freeze up. So that, I think there are headwinds and tailwinds, and I think that for us the challenge really would be to try and focus and maximize the, you know, the momentum that you get from the tailwind, and minimize the obstacles that you have by way of headwinds. So that really is a challenge for the government.
And there's also a rise in clarity in terms of that most of these schemes, as Mr. Dasgupta referred to, cannot really work in silos. You know, it has to be, there has to be greater convergence in terms of implementation.
Implementation has always been an Achilles heel. We have wonderful blueprints, but translating them into action has
always... And the role of the state governments here.
Role of the state governments, role, it's always the implementing agency. That's where we always fall short. So I think it's a slow process. But I think we're getting there, because in a country like India, I think change will necessarily be slow. We're too huge a country, too diverse a country. So I think it's important that we just keep at it. And rather than talking in terms of double-digit growth, which I think, frankly, is almost impossible for us, what we need to have is sustained growth, 7% plus, 7 to 8% plus year after year. Mm-hmm. And that's what's important, along with employment opportunities. Mm-hmm. I think that will get us there. So I think it's important that we don't try to, you know, mm-hmm. put the cart before the horse. Get our systems in place, mm-hmm. and slowly but surely we get there, and not lose heart, mm-hmm. because frauds, NPAs, these are part of modern capitalism.
Okay.
So that is the price that you pay. But the most important, I think, is our criminal justice system. Mm-hmm. I think he spoke about the fact that, you know, no bank official is penalized. I wish he'd look back to see the Harshad Mehta scam. Mm-hmm. The only people apart from Harshad Mehta who were really put in prison behind bars mm-hmm. were a number of bank officials, many of whose mm-hmm. guilt was not proven. Right. So I think that is very important. The criminal mm-hmm. justice system, and should work.
And the very significance of this can be understood from the fact that the economic survey of this year talks about judiciary and the criminal justice system.
So that is where we need to really work. The huge vacancies in judiciary, the fact mm-hmm. that every case meanders through courts and you have one law for the one for the rich and one for the poor, that's where I think we really need to address. That's something that no government has really been able to tackle, given the fact that we do have, you know, the mm-hmm. judiciary, the executive, and the government legislature
final,
as distinct
final
wings.
Final word on the program, you know, last 5 minutes. Professor Agarwal, what this really means for the markets, the GDP numbers, how this impacts the overall markets sentiment when we look at GDP numbers, which talk about 7.2% growth?
No, I think they will have a positive impetus on the mm-hmm. the whole functioning of not only the people within the country, but even from the overseas market. Mm-hmm. When it comes to jobs, which you're talking about, it's important to understand that jobs always taken by the people of this country as government giving them something, mm-hmm. which is not supposed to be there. It is supposed to be from the market. And I think we need to look at that with the FDI coming into India, which mm-hmm. used to come 10 years back, used to be setting up organically and doing everything. Now the things have changed, they're going in an organic way. That means you're looking at immediately coming in there, taking over, which I will bring in that job component faster. Mm-hmm. These investment summits, which are taking place different states, will also bring in some incentives. And the government is also projecting, like recently the defense setup, which is to be there in the UP, which is bordering Madhya Pradesh mm-hmm. and UP, where about 20,000 crores has been set aside by the government for setting up defense facilities and other organizations coming in. Now that is a headway going forward, the infrastructure framework and the budget outlays, and especially agriculture, in my opinion, is very critical. Mm-hmm. You know, they have tried to lock in these mandis, and I have also suggested creating a mobile mandi or a mandi on wheels which can actually go to the farm and reduce the cost. Mm-hmm. You can see the implementation of Aadhaar, which is critical, biometric. Mm-hmm. Already about 3 crore mm-hmm. Ration cards, fake ration cards have disappeared. That means reduction in subsidy, which was just going out to people who did not need it, has been curtailed. Mm-hmm. So there are other benefits which will go forward. We also suggested about a year back about setting up a national labor exchange where labor or time of human being is considered to be as a wealth. And large number of countries are working, and we received a response from Ministry of Labor also that they're also looking at in terms of creating that. Mm-hmm. That will give an impetus to create efficient market, labor markets, and give an impetus. I think for the last 3-4 months, the mm-hmm. government is extensively focused on how do we bring in not only growth mm-hmm. but jobs as well. Okay. So all their objectives, all these 19, 20, 30 mm-hmm. agenda which Prime Minister has been looking at, has been now shifted towards mm-hmm. bringing in that growth and jobs. And mm-hmm. I feel the fact that the Prime Minister's office is monitoring this at every moment, mm-hmm. despite all what is happening in the economy, the focus is still there, and we will see that happen. It is not a day's event. Okay. It will take time. We'll have to give them a year and a half to do happen.
The budget speech of 2018-19, the minister said 70 lakh formal jobs are expected to be created this year, and the infrastructure investment estimated at over 50 lakh crore rupees. In fact, we also saw an all-time high allocation for roads and the railway sector. Final word on the program from here, you know, if one has to really look at the road ahead, it is primarily we have to just sustain the growth rate which we have at this stage. You know, achieved, and look at the factors which can further propel growth.
Sure. Mm-hmm. You see, the GDP figures that have come out are obviously positive, mm-hmm. and it gives a feel-good factor, I would say. Mm-hmm. But beyond that, there is a lot of work to be done.
Okay.
You know, on implementation, mm-hmm. on keeping to the right track, mm-hmm. and when you talk about growth, exactly what Maithili said, we don't need double-digit growth mm-hmm. and be the fastest-growing economy mm-hmm. or etc. What we need is sustained high growth mm-hmm. with low inflation. Mm-hmm. Because you can have 9% growth, but if your inflation is 13%, it doesn't make any sense at all.
Right.
So that has to be looked into.
Mm-hmm. Okay, final word on the program from you, Maithili. Sustained high growth with low inflation. Overall, what really should be the strategy ahead for the, as far as economy policy making is concerned?
Well, there are a lot of things that are outside your control, exogenous, as I told you, what happens to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. But there are some things within your control. Mm-hmm. And I think here the biggest, I think, takeaway for the government is don't make mistakes. Don't make policy mistakes. Sure. So we tread very carefully and cross the river by feeling the stones. Mm-hmm. So don't try to go in for, you know, when even in the case of, say, NPAs or any kind of, and meanwhile go after the reforms, mm-hmm. judicial reform and reform in factor markets like labor and land. Mm-hmm. Land, we've not had much success. Labor is essentially a state subject. So I think it's important for us to go slowly but surely. Disinvestment, there are still a number of low-hanging fruits, and please address the problems in judiciary. I mm-hmm. think judiciary, the fact that we have so many frauds with our judicial system, that is perhaps one of the biggest obstacles to sustain.
And are you also hopeful that the private investment will pick up?
Yes, it already is picking up. But mm-hmm. as I said, ultimately at the bottom of every agreement is a contract.
Right.
Now, every time there's a problem in the contract, if you go to the courts and you never get justice,
right.
then you are not going to have any kind of commerce taking place. So mm-hmm. I think today, the fact that the criminal justice system and the judiciary just doesn't function and doesn't function honestly, mm-hmm. is perhaps one of the biggest handicaps, and we need to address that.
Right. So judiciary, criminal justice system, again, is a very, very important issue when we talk about economic policy making and how it's impacting the investor confidence. Thanks very much, all of you, for joining us on this program. And that's all we have for you in this edition of Inside. Thanks very much for watching.